longest, the youngest, and most exciting chain of mountains in the world. Built by volcanic fires, cut down by ice, grinding valleys ever deeper. It takes 1,000 years for this slow glacial flood to reach the sea. But these great glaciers are merely remnants of an immense ice cap, which once covered the Andes 2 miles thick. Now, in this twilight of the Ice Age, its force is spent. Instead, the sea pounds the shattered remnants of the Andes where they reach south toward the bottom of the world, and the oceans unite against Cape Horn. To stand on Cape Horn, an island deserted even by the sailing ships which once struggled by, is to know why this playground of storms was feared. Even the resilient tussock grass has been ripped by the famous gales which can strike from a clear sky. The cloak of shrubs clinging to a few lonely slopes has been cut low by the wind. While the giant petrel scavenges along the empty shores for carrion, the victims of storms. Beyond this feared and famous cliff, Cape Horn itself, a maze of channels stretches north to form the greatest archipelago of fjords and islands on the face of the globe. Uncounted, often unexplored, uninhabited, the land of fire, Tierra del Fuego. A graveyard of wrecks, a forgotten, dangerous land stripped bare by the wind and waves. The ice withdrew, the sea replaced it, invading the mountains. Their volcanic rock falls sheer to the deep fjords. Level ground is scarce and poorly drained. The ice-covered hollows are filled with bogs dangerously deep, fringed by sphagnum moss, sedges, and lichen. They thrive on water. More than 16 feet of rain fall every year. The westerly wind circles the globe before dumping its moisture on these sodden islands, and three depressions can blow through in a single day. Rain and sleet are the norm, but the squalls pass quickly, and rock cormorants preen their feathers. Kelp goose. The gander is white, but his mate appears almost black to escape detection on her nest. Here in a land with no grass, they've adapted to feed on sea lettuce, which grows close along the shore. Tumbled rocks are a safe refuge for sea otters, which emerge to romp in a rare glimpse of sun. These are the world's smallest otters, among the most playful of all animals. They feed on crabs living beyond the reach of the storms, down among the roots of the giant kelp. One of the few kinds of mammals to survive the punishing climate of this desolate region. South American terns patrol the floating kelp beds, searching for fish. Although the land is so barren, the sea abounds with life. The narrow strip of shore revealed at low tide attracts the blackish oyster catcher and the chimango hawk. He's found a limpet. The chimango is a land bird like a crow, but it's learned to feed on the rich beds of mussels when it can. The ringed kingfisher calls from the edge of the forest growing on the more sheltered islands of the Beagle Channel. The branches are draped in wisps of the lichen usnea, spread by the wind from tree to tree. All life here bows to the wind. The spring gales cut a trail of devastation in these lonely forests of evergreen southern beach. In the natural cold storage, the fallen timber lies for years without rotting. There are 400 species of moss, and many forms of lichen drink from the sodden bark. The forest has a cold beauty. Overhead, Darwin's fungus, once a staple of the Indians' diet, glows like little oranges, and below, pernetia berries brighten the forest floor. The bounty of summer is short, and the forest birds must be resourceful in finding food, including the austral parakeets, which surprisingly live in this cold part of South America. The woods also echo with the labor of one of the world's most spectacular woodpeckers, the Magellanic woodpecker. He batters his way into the refuge of the grubs of beetles, which hide beneath the bark. The female is mostly black and calls constantly to her mate. The beetles kill the trees, so the woodpecker may do more good than harm to the forest. Their nest is hollowed in the heart of a fine southern beach, where they're feeding their brood. Torrents race through the woods, dashing down the slopes to meet the channels below. Here the wild fowl come to drink the peat-stained water. The loggerhead duck, also called a steamer duck. These big, powerful birds can weigh up to 22 pounds. Through evolution, they've lost the power of flight. They have tiny wings armed with sharp spurs on the elbows for fighting. Their wings are adapted for diving after shellfish. The upland goose is related to the North American white-fronted goose and pairs for life. It's also extremely aggressive. This one is attacking a male kelp goose, whose mate joins in the fray to defend her nest. The commotion spreads to the steamer ducks, which take to the water. The sailors of the graceful clipper ships thought they looked like clumsy paddle steamer tugs and contemptuously called them steamer ducks. Perhaps the most famous of all the southern birds are the penguins. Though you would hardly think they were birds at all, the only flying they do is underwater. Able to outmaneuver fish and squid, they spend half the feeding year far out at sea. In the broad waters of the Magellan Strait, they come ashore each spring to nest on Magdalena Island. The explorer, Magellan, found them here and salted thousands into barrels to feed his crew. He then sailed on to discover the Pacific. Called the Magellanic penguin, today their flesh is used by man mainly for fish bait. Over centuries, penguin feet have worn paths to the top of the cliff. The island resounds to their donkey-like braying and is honeycombed with their nest burrows, each defended by a sharp beak. In November, they are busy nesting, some gathering grass to line their damp burrows. After 6 weeks incubation, the eggs hatch, but during that time, each adult may sit for up to 2 weeks continuously. It's his turn. The off-duty parents head for the beach, hunger spurring them on. Despite their apparent dignity, penguins can be careless. Fortunately, they're tough. Though in a large colony, there are some not tough enough. Death does not pass unnoticed. Here the huge hunters of the Andes, the condors, gather to scavenge from the shore rather than inland. These giant birds range over 4,000 miles along the length of South America, and more than any other creature, symbolize the wild spirit of the untamed peaks. To the north, across the Magellan Strait, the mainland of South America begins with the plains of Patagonia. Beyond loom the snows of the Andes. Darwin's rhea, an ostrich-like bird, is yet another that can't fly, so it has strong legs which can carry it fast across the open grasslands to outrun danger. Normally they eat grass, insects, and seeds, but this one seemed to have acquired a taste for dandelions, imported by accident from Britain. The seeds have blown to the four corners of Patagonia in the strong winds. It's the male which looks after the brood, hatched from the eggs of several different females that lay in the same nest. Thank you. long neck is a useful periscope, watching the horizon for danger with large, keen eyes. One of the most characteristic sounds of the southern Andes is the honk of the buff-necked ibis. Their long beaks are adapted to probe for insects in marshy ground. Each spring, they migrate south to nests, which grow into a tower of sticks protecting their inelegant young. Powerful flyers, they're found high in the Andes. Farther north again, now 300 miles north of Cape Horn, the granite towers of the Piney Range stand above the Patagonian grasslands. The giant condors are plentiful, soaring in the westerly wind, which deflects upwards from the mountainsides. Almost 10 feet in wingspan, they have the biggest wing area of any bird, a stature to challenge the grandeur of the Andes. The strong splayed feathers on their wingtips help them to hang in the air, effortlessly soaring. Their big tail steers them with ease through the turbulence of the mountain air currents. True masters of the Andes. To survive in this weather-beaten land, plants have adapted to strange conditions. This flower, the Oricea, grows only in the spray of waterfalls. The Magellanic pea clings close to the shelter of the ground. And Calceolarias bob on heavy stalks. The firebush leans away from the wind. Rivers run milky with sediment from the glaciers, the valleys granting shelter for dwarf beech forests. This dramatic, beautiful land is the home of a supremely successful predator, the puma. The lion of the Andes. Persecuted by man, the puma has learned to hunt by night and alone. But the Andes are so vast, and here in the south so undisturbed, that pumas can still be glimpsed by day as they warily come together in the spring. The puma once preyed mostly on the guanaco, a relative of the camel, which once ranged the entire length of the Andes from sea level up to 13,000 feet. Now they only survive where they are protected from hunters. These are young male guanacos, learning to sort out who's boss in bouts of friendly rivalry. Guanacos are animals of open grasslands. The mountains to the west drag all the moisture from the wind, and here the vegetation is adapted to drought. Spiny cushion plants protect tough grasses from the dry wind. The guanaco has also learned to browse the new growth of the thorny shrubs. Blowing from the Patagonian ice cap, the wind is intensely cold. To keep their thick coats in good condition, the guanacos dust bathe. Their feet don't have hooves, but soft pads which don't damage the fragile vegetation. The young males challenge each other to contest of supremacy with necks and teeth. The object is to get your opponent down. Above, the mature males stand guard over their groups of females and young. The first few days of life are the most dangerous for the calves. When sudden storms rage through the mountains, killing with their cold. The new burden of fresh snow brings down great avalanches daily from the peaks. As the air clears, the condors sail forth on the gusts, searching for the weak and dying. Condors are scavengers like vultures, and their keen eyes miss little on the open ground. They circle like giant black moths, drawn to the last flicker of life. This newly born but sickly calf is dying. The condors watch and wait. Sensing death, the other guanacos move restlessly. Even when the baby is dead, the mother will not leave its side. Birds of prey begin to gather. First, the caracaras. A crested caracara, a big bird, the size of a raven. Instinctively, the mother drives it away. A white-throated caracara. Smaller, but bolder. Above, the condors begin to gather. Wary birds and clumsy on the ground, they size up the situation from the safety of the air. This one spreads his feathers and lowers his feet to slow his descent. His claws have caught up lichen from a tree. He's a male with a crest. The condor tears at the body, securing food for its own hungry young. But the bond between the mother guanaco and her dead calf is still strong. She charges the condor. Mother continued her hopeless vigil for 3 days. In its whole lifetime, a guanaco is most at risk in the first few hours. This one has just been born. It does not yet know where to find its mother's milk, and the wind is bitterly cold. The mother can only stand still. If it doesn't feed before nightfall, this calf too will die. The danger is past. Beneath the piney mountains, black-necked swans carry their cygnets safely above the waves. The lakes, carved by glaciers, are deep and cold. Many kinds of wildfowl flock here in the spring. Chilliwee widgeon, white-winged coots, red shoveler ducks. Tuscaroba swan shepherds its brood. The most common birds of the grassland are upland geese, and every little pool has its family. Cygnets, a swan's down coat is no luxury. Without it, they could not survive in this bleak but beautiful land. Leading north stand the frozen cliffs of the Andes, towering above the land of geese and wind. In this southern hemisphere, journeying north means warmer days. The slopes of loose rocks are no longer held by ice and waste away the mountains. These crumbling, inaccessible heights are the last refuge of the Andean deer. It was first classified by scientists as a horse, then as one of the South American camels. No wonder it turns its back on those who changed its name in the textbooks 21 times. Sturdily built, it easily climbs the steep slopes as far as the snow line. Those mule-like ears alert to the slightest sounds. Patagonian ice cap, 600 miles north of Cape Horn, hides beneath an insulating blanket of clouds. The last remnants of the great ice sheet, which cut down the Andes, reach toward the Pacific Ocean. This glacier is 15 miles long and 2 miles wide. An ice cliff 230 feet high meets the salt tides of the Pacific. As the water ebbs, the ice becomes unstable. Ice forms icebergs and immense waves. The sun warms the air, and the great icebergs melt in the fjords. At sea level, yet this is the latitude equivalent to the vineyards of Bordeaux in the northern hemisphere. In this continent of extremes, the forest which leans to the farthest reaches of the icy tides appears almost tropical in its green abundance of ferns. It's still cold, but it's now a temperate rainforest. No frost ever touches these flowers. The illusion of the tropics is heightened by the presence of a hummingbird. It hangs its nest from a single strand of bamboo, fashioned from moss and spiders' webs. It's called the green-backed firecrown. It can even survive cold spells by hibernating. But for the youngsters, it's more important to be sword swallowers. The red flowers of shrubs like fuchsia attract birds to pollinate them on the open fjords, where there are few pollinating insects. But the forest, hung with bamboo, is a warmer world, full of surprises. A giant stick insect. It mimics the dead twigs of the fuchsia, which is the food of the pudu, the Andean dwarf deer. Forest ring to the strange call of the chukau, a secretive bird which lurks in the undergrowth and throws its ringing calls around the trees like a ventriloquist. This gloomy forest is sodden from the frequent rain brought by the westerly winds, and creatures take advantage of the damp. A bootlace leech homes in on the blood of a victim. And behind it coils a truly elephantine leech. It peers dimly through the gloom despite four pairs of tiny eyes on the end of its trunk. It gropes through the forest litter in search of worms. It's fully 20 inches long. Another creature of the forest floor is this snake. Favorite food is not lizards, but frogs. Frogs that really know how to hide. C- Confident in their camouflage, Darwin's frogs tend to ignore passersby, however enormous. They come in coats of many colors to mingle with the green and brown leaves. But sometimes, they choose the wrong color. Darwin's frog has a trick. As it strikes the water, it goes rigid and floats out of danger, disguised by the muddled pattern of its belly. This frog has a different defense strategy. From the rear, it looks like a beast about to spring. While this inoffensive weevil has a backside that mimics a bug-eyed monster. The forest is full of insects, weird and wonderful. Many are new to science, and next to nothing is known about their lives or how they fit with their strange behavior into this constantly new world. A harvest man, disguised as a beast from another planet. The forest, between the mountains and the sea, stretches 1,000 miles up the Pacific coast, becoming warmer and drier until above it tower the great volcanoes, like Osorno. Andes have been raised by the buckling and sliding of the crust of the earth. Their growth continues with every earthquake, even now. Volcanoes release the heat generated by the massive forces deep beneath the mountains. There are 2,000 volcanoes in Chile alone. These are but the latest of the generations of volcanoes that have risen and been eroded away as the Andes have climbed into the sky. A young range like the Andes has steep rivers. Their rapids fill the water with oxygen, and they have become the home of an extraordinary bird. Torrent duck. This is the male. Below the water, the weed is the home of the larvae of the stonefly, being hunted by this Cenclodes. Long ago, the torrent duck carved a niche for itself, feeding only on the stonefly larvae, which depend on highly oxygenated water. Ducks cheat the current using every pressure wave and eddy. They appear completely indifferent to the wild water in which they feed. A drab duckling stands above the colorful female. It, too, hesitates for only a moment before plunging into the foam. They hatch with large feet to help them almost run across the surface of the rapid. Volcanoes which dominate the landscape. Here, Chelyan is venting steam. Yaima smolders gently, but its tranquility is deceptive. In 1957, this black flood of lava burned away a huge expanse of forest before cooling and halting in a wall 33 feet high. Andean lavas are especially viscous and slow-moving. The edges cool and channel the flow. This island was spared to witness what was destroyed. What remains of the forest shows it to be one of the strangest in the world of monkey puzzle trees, the ancient Araucarian pine. Its spiny cones contain hundreds of nuts. The tree was named for the spirals of spiky leaves, enough to puzzle any monkey. But a unique parrot, the slender-billed parakeet, has a long bill adapted to cope. And it has other uses. Delicate footwork comes in handy, too. As the sun sets, a young red-backed hawk calls to be fed by its parents. The young hawk is a strong flyer, but it hasn't really mastered landing. The noisy parakeets head for their roost. And on the forest floor, the little creatures of the night begin to stir. The great horned owl wakes from a day-long sleep. The little Monita del Monte, an opossum, wakes too, while her babies sleep on. Mate ventures out to hunt insects. The opossums are among the most ancient inhabitants of South America. Thank you. the mother goes, her babies go too, piggyback. Sun lingers, softening the cold barren heights which curve north toward the greatest mountain of the longest range in the world. Towering far above the other peaks, 22,830 feet high, the highest mountain in the Americas, Aconcagua. Beyond, ever northward, leads the flight of the Condor. Toward the equator, the driest desert and the vast steaming forests of the Amazon, following the fiery backbone of South America.